Interesting point, of course, when we saw recent numbers, the only sector seeming to be booming was the agriculture sector. Manufacturing services were all down so much. So in that sense, you don't think that even with the agriculture sector booming, the fact is it just can't sustain the amount of people or the population which is depending on it right now?
Absolutely critical. You've hit the nail on the head. And for me, this is one of those disappointments about India, as I mentioned, that what runs in our DNA, it seems, even in the political class, is a lot of statism and socialism. Because if you look at the so-called right of the center parties in the West, they're very clear on their economic policies, which is that the economic policies are distinctly much more oriented towards being business friendly and being free market. In India's case, that is the point that all the political parties, including the BJP, have a great belief in statism and socialism. And so therefore, we are never able to carry out the kind of economic reforms that other countries did to become much richer nations.
Right. And as I said, let's see how the future of those bills, currently those farm bills which are being which were cleared, but let's see what the political fallout of that actually happens if they go through. But rule number five, Richard, for you, is that successful nations make the most of their location. Now, for India, of course, geopolitically, there's the issue of the hostile neighbors, currently China, Pakistan, but we are, in terms of trade also, not very neighborly at all.
So this is one of the biggest fault lines as far as India is concerned, that if you look at what happened to other countries that developed rapidly, they were able to do so by exporting a lot regionally. Intra-regional trade was very strong. Southeast Asia comes to mind here, obviously. Europe, many decades, if not centuries ago, that intra-regional trade in those places was very strong. You trade a lot with your neighbors because that's the easiest thing to do. The two regions where intra-regional trade has been very weak because of hostilities and other factors is South Asia and Africa. So this is something which again India has to consider, and how things have shifted. When Prime Minister Modi first came to power in 2014, he spoke about this much more of a regional outreach. Now, because of circumstances, our own domestic politics, we have further gone down the line of having an unfriendly neighborhood, and that is obviously not conducive for faster economic growth. And this is something I keep repeating in my book, that all I'm trying to do is to show you as to what did other nations do to grow rapidly. What are the 10 rules that we need to follow to try and grow rapidly and get out of poverty and become a middle income nation? That is the entire focus of the book, that this is what other nations have done. And what is it that we are doing currently, and how does it match up to those countries? So, of course, whether it comes to state spending, whether it comes to intra-regional trade, for everything we can have an excuse. Oh, this is why we are not trading more. This is why we have to spend much more given our society and the number of poor. But all I'm trying to tell you is that if you do that, the chances of you achieving high economic growth are much lower.
And for, in fact, the interesting part, because this was another focus of the government when it came in 2014, was also about smart cities, that developing India beyond Delhi, Mumbai, Surat, the commercial capitals. Now, of course, these are the cities that have been hit the hardest in the current corona pandemic as well, because of the high population of migrant workers, the exodus, now people coming back. Why, in a sense, has India not been able to develop almost satellite cities or these smart cities in a way which is economically viable, commercially viable as well? Why did we see those horrific images, really a second partition of people walking thousands of kilometers to go back to where they actually came from?
Right. Yeah. So this is another very interesting contrast with China, that if you look at the number of new cities that China was able to develop, and new cities I define as places which start with a population of, let's say, less than a quarter million, and then the population ended up booming to over a million. The number of new cities that China was able to develop during its development stage, there were like nearly 20 new cities which came up in China, cities you never heard of. In India's case, we've hardly seen any new cities come up. And I think that this is really happening because of our urban development policies, and also because there's so much concentration of power, I think, which still remains in capital cities, whether at the chief minister level at the states, because we focus a lot on the politics in Delhi and what's happening in Delhi. But this is something where I think even the chief ministers at the state need to think a lot more, that everybody functions as a bit of a supremo. Mm-hmm. And so they're reluctant to divest too much power.